And good evening, everybody. How are you? This is Jeff Gelman of Solid Canine Training. And don't forget Jeff Gelman Seminars. If you go to jeffgelmanseminars.com, that's jeffgelmanseminars.com, you can get your tickets to either the Chicago seminar or the Mantua, New Jersey seminar coming up. And those are coming up actually rather quickly. So you want to secure that. You can do a working spot, an audit spot. If you're a trainer, if you're a dog owner, they're geared towards both. You will learn how to eliminate all your behavioral problems and then be proactive on training the dog. And then you'll also learn all about state of mind. That's really, really important. But let's get right into the show. Hello, Joelle. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. This is lovely Joelle. My name is Jeff. This is the What Would Jeff Do show. We stream every Monday and Friday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Our Wednesday now is for our 90-day fast track people. What 90-day fast track is, and Joel will be putting up a link, I'm sure, a couple of times during this podcast. The 90-day fast track is intense coaching, and where we look at your videos. It has its own separate community within our community. So people upload their videos, upload photos, upload scenarios, ask questions. Plus, they get the live coaching twice a week. That goes on for 90 days. And it is incredible how well your dog can do and you can do. You can have in 3 months, less than that actually, probably within the first month, dramatic change. If you're right now just lost with your dog, if you're just, you know what, I've had enough. I haven't really done anything with my dog. I'm going to start now. I can't put up with this anymore. My family can't put up with it anymore. Dog is sort of ruining my life, limiting my life. If you take even our most basic course, which is the Green to Graduate course, which is in the community, we have an online community. What does this look like? It's up a little bit too high.
It probably is.
It's within a week, your life can dramatically change. That's it. 1 week. Anyway, put your questions in. Everybody on Rumble, everybody on Instagram, everybody on Facebook and YouTube, we appreciate you so much. If you're listening to the podcast, we appreciate you as well, obviously. This is a Q&A show. A lot of people ask questions about unwanted behaviors. I mean, you can actually live with a dog that's not trained. But living with a dog with some serious behavioral issues, some serious state of mind issues, you just can't. You can't. But if like so many people don't have it, the dog has minimal training or barely any training, they live fine. You know, it's not maybe they don't have huge expectations of the dog, but things are fine. Mm-hmm. They're safe. Kids are safe. Guests are safe. You know, the other dogs in the house are safe. The cat's safe. You know, they have a fenced in yard. The dog doesn't pull that bad on the leash. It's fine. But when you have a dog with unwanted behaviors, especially dangerous ones, it's a lot of times life or death. This is the one industry where not too many people are dying because of a bad haircut, a bad manicure, pedicure, joining a gym and not showing up unless you're morbidly obese, getting a bad meal at a restaurant unless you get food poisoning and die, fucking up a recipe at home. Your house isn't all that clean. You know, you can't afford it. But nobody's dying. But this is one thing where, like, it's life or death. It really, really is. I mean, dogs, bottom line is this. What other creature other than a dog can you just take to a vet and put down? You just can't. I mean, certain countries now are doing assisted suicide. But, you know, it's common that we put our animals down for all kinds of things, you know, sickness, behavioral issues. And that's why it's important that you do these things. And nobody wants to, but lots of people are. And I understand it. Your dog bites your kids constantly. You can't have that dog in your house. Nobody wants that dog. So I think we need to take accountability for our own actions. Don't think anybody's going to come in and rescue you. We're going to dramatically help you, but it's your dog. You're going to live with it. So we want to teach you on how to do things. That's why we have all of our online courses. I think Joel put up a post of another, if your dog is touch that's we don't touch. Literally, we have dogs that people can't pet. Owners can't pet their dogs without getting bit.
I know, it sounds crazy.
Yeah, owners.
We get these dogs in pretty often, actually.
Owners can't put a, we don't use harnesses, but they can't put a harness on their dog. They can't put a flat buckle collar on the dog, martingale on the dog.
Even like brushing their dog or vet visits, you know, the vet touching the dog.
It turns into not just a nip, but to total, everything from a nip to a total attack. I've had clients that if you've tried to wipe off their muddy paws. The dog's muddy paws. Just that, like, you just wipe off their paws. I've had clients that have been put in the hospital. And these are small dogs, by the way. This dog I'm specifically talking about is a bulldog. Put her and her mother in the hospital. Just wiping their paws. We fixed it, obviously. In the same protocol, we're going to show you how we fix things for April 1st, if I got the date right on that one. We're doing a free, it's free, right?
It's free training.
Free training.
Yeah. Live.
Yeah. We're launching a new course. And we have a puppy here. It started today for 2 weeks. Just a little bit. We don't do normally 2 week boarding trains, but it's just a one-on-one client that also boards with us. And they just wanted like, you know what? She's moving. So she's like, you know, let me have you, which is smart to do, by the way, when you're moving, go board your dog somewhere. Just do some, you know, start him off. He's a young puppy. Start him off. So I would be doing some clicker food training with the dog. And we'll probably document some of that. Mm-hmm. Took a dog to the park today with Angelo. It was hot outside. I'm feeling heat stuff coming on. It was hot outside today.
It's almost April.
And yeah. It's like, I'm like, wow, I need to double my hydration.
My favorite time of year.
Yeah. But you got to watch out for your lack of hydration. Mm-hmm. You'd be really, really careful about that. All right. So let's get right into the questions. What do we got?
Roddy Kirk says, hey, guys. Hey, Roddy.
Oh, hey, Roddy. How are you? How's things going over in Scotland?
Snuggle Bun says, hey, everyone. Hey, Snuggle Bun.
Hey.
Let's see. Jan says, howdy.
Hey, Jan. Howdy to you.
Alicia, hey, good evening. I watched the replay from Friday and I saw your questions following my question. So I'll expand some more now. So the 4-year-old GSD is a female and you asked about her behavior. She is pretty well behaved. Okay. I'd say she is on verbal recall, but she could use some
prepping. Okay, good.
Because when we take her to Chuck It or to the park, you can tell she thinks twice before returning on a recall. Also, when Sue plays with other dogs, I've never seen her play bow, but mostly she does that stiff running on the side of the other. Oh yeah, so like herding type.
She's herding behavior, sheriffing. Yep. And these are the dogs that fight.
I don't remember.
Yeah, shoot.
Oh, here we go. On another dog, when they have a toy, she nips on the back of their neck, but it appears to be playful.
Yep.
Doesn't seem excessive. I've never seen her meet a puppy, but overall, she definitely could use some conditioning. I just don't think my boyfriend will do it because he thinks she's really well behaved.
Well, it sounds like, again, like that's why we do consults, so we can have video and, you know, we can talk back and forth. It sounds like this dog is just sheriffing and it's trying to control all the dogs in the scenario. It's not the worst unless it does it to the wrong dog. But the fact that if you think that it needs work and your boyfriend is like everything is fine, there's got to be, I think the truth is somewhere in the middle. Mm. So number one is you both need to be on the same page, number one. But from what you described, you can stop a dog from sheriffing really quickly with like the out command. You don't want to recall. You can recall your dog off the other dog, but teaching it out so it just moves away from the other dog, you can do that. And things are fine until they're not, so you have to be careful. But all that play biting, especially the neck, that's a lot of dogs do that, and it never goes farther than that. That's just rough play. A lot of dogs will like grab each other's necks and like. Really, they make noise. It looks like to the uneducated eye, not yours necessarily, but it's like, oh my gosh, they're fighting. It's like, please, Those freaking guys have been doing that for the last 5 years. It's like, that's what they do. Like, hurt. Back when Bert was alive, Bert and Wes used to do that all the time. And I had Girl and Kira used to do that all the time. And a lot of dogs do that. They bite each other's butts and when they chase. And it's not always the worst thing, especially within your own pack. It's not the worst thing. But if you want to make it better, we can help you make it better. Next.
Alicia said, win with Figaro. I was gone an hour and a half. He slept in his kennel the entire time. Look at that.
That's good.
You join our community and you get results.
That's good. Yeah.
She finally went to e-collar with him.
Well. Yeah. Hour and a half is good. Especially if you didn't get much more than that.
No, he was like frantic in the kennel.
Yeah.
Panting, drooling.
Yeah. Once you start patterning it, patterning relaxation, you'd be surprised how quickly length of time escalates, meaning you get more time. Like, even this is the second time this puppy has been here. The first time you were out of town, it cried constantly, shit and piss in its crate constantly, never settled down.
Sounds like a fun time.
I had it.
Glad I wasn't here for it.
Yeah, it was constant. This time, just it was only here for what, 4 days maybe? This time it's only peed, had an accident once in its crate, and it barely whines. It'll whine outside once in a while when it wants to come in, but it's not really making noise in here. And it was always standing up, and now it's like right now, it's like lying down. When we looked at it the other night, the other podcast, it was also lying down. So it's patterning. Everything is patterned. Everything is patterning. Being consistent and patterning. Put it this way. Your badly behaved dog has been patterned to badly behave. It's predicted. Your badly behaved dog is trained to misbehave. For instance, my dog jumps on people. Okay, so if I walk in your house, what's your dog going to do? Jump on you. Great, it's been trained to jump on people. No, I never trained it to do that. Well, you didn't stop it. Therefore, you trained it. It's no different than technically free shaping. Free shaping is you wait to capture something the dog does, and then you mark it and reward it. So theoretically, you screaming at your dog for jumping on people, and then it gets off. And then if you reward it, you're technically, you're almost free shaping a jump. And it's sort of a far stretch, but it's what you don't stop, you train. What you don't say no to.
It's not a far stretch at all.
What you don't say no to.
Literally how we trick train.
Yeah.
We like capture behaviors.
Yeah. Yeah. What you don't correct, you reward. Next.
Stacy, I didn't acknowledge how bad my dogs were. I just accepted that. The cats run, the dogs chase. The cat has plenty of free zones, like the fire sprinklers. She can move from room to room.
Yeah.
Then I found, I don't know where the rest is. Hold on. We went to school. We failed basic canine exam, the stranger approach. They cannot be trusted to not snap at strangers' hands. I can put muzzles on them. They're not pandemic pets, but fall of 2018, just before the world closed down for the pandemic.
Yeah, and that's another thing. It's like, we don't let people get away with a pandemic excuse. School shut down, workplaces shut down.
We got a lot of shit for continuing to train dogs.
Remember?
We got mad heat on social media.
But we went to places that
were open.
That were open. We didn't break into closed businesses.
I know. And but it was like dogs. Weird, the mindset. It's like so, people didn't want us out at all.
So it's okay to go to, well, don't even get me started on the whole.
I know, let's not go down the rabbit hole.
The scamdemic, or the plandemic. But this is the thing is, if you can walk around Home Depot and shop for paint, you can walk your dog around Home Depot and shop for paint.
But that's what we got shit for.
Because there's no correlation.
It wasn't, what's the word?
Necessary.
Necessary.
Yes, it was.
It wasn't, what was the word they were using a lot during all that?
We're assholes.
Essential. It wasn't essential trips. Remember for a time they were like, you should only go out if it's essential.
That's so stupid because it's like that means
like grocery shopping and like
but
even people were getting that delivered
anyway.
Such a
weird anyway, we don't. You can still take your dog to places. Ow. You can still take your dog to places. Yes. Don't be surprised. Don't beat yourself up about the hand reaching to the passing a test. A lot of dogs don't like that. A lot of dogs don't like that. And you know, and it's funny because nobody pets our dogs. I mean, our dogs aren't going to bite hands, but that's fine because we don't let people pet our dogs. I was at the park today with Angelo and kids and adults and people walked by and saw Simon and like, oh, that's a good looking dog. And I was like, thanks, but nobody asked to pet him for once, which is great. I would have just said no. Yeah. Next.
Alicia said, we also had Success e-collar healing in some in Home Depot today. Nikki's dogs are very distracting for him though. Yeah.
Yeah. That's great. That's great training. Mm-hmm. That's great training. And make sure you're doing the training without Nikki's dogs. So the dog knows what it looks like.
Yeah.
And you know what it feels like.
You don't want him getting that false sense of confidence. Like, oh, I'm with my pack.
Right. So, and then add the distraction. But sometimes the distraction, it's not a distraction. It's the dog does better. Like a lot of dogs will be more confident in a pack, but more nervous without of a pack. Out of a pack. Next.
Roddy said, "You guys doing okay?"
Yeah, yeah, we're doing great. We're doing great. Country's going down the tubes, but we're doing great. We'll see you soon. Actually, we're not going to be going to Scotland, but
no.
No.
Let's see. Alicia said, "I've never seen her meet a puppy, but overall, she definitely could use some conditioning." Oh, I already read that. Just kidding. Sam White. Hey guys, Winebag went to another class inside. She recalled to me with 10 dogs 5 feet from her.
Nice.
I was so happy I cried. But 5 minutes later, walking to the car, she lost her shit on a dog she was with for 2 hours.
I know.
Also, she whined the entire 2 hours, literally never stopped, thinking she just needs massive exposure for the reactivity.
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of weird. Dogs in class, it's like in a closed environment.
They know.
They know. They just know.
Or and she's then, like, I'll see you outside.
And then you take him outside and it's like, it's the real world. That's why Mother Nature fucks everything up. That's why you need to push. That's why I'm always baffled by people that are like, don't bring your dog above threshold. It's like, are you serious? How could you not train your dog above threshold? It'll never go anywhere. It'll never do anything. Like you have to do all these things that first you teach your basics and then you push them above threshold and make sure that they understand that you do have to do the exact same thing above threshold that you were doing below threshold. Next.
Alicia said he's trying to convince me to get a puppy and not crate train because he thinks the female will keep the puppy in check, but I'm planning to crate train.
Fucking kidding me.
I don't trust another dog to raise my puppy.
Okay.
That sounds like a disaster waiting to happen.
But, you know, I don't want to know. This is okay. That's just stupid.
Don't listen to your boyfriend for dog training advice. Come to the professionals for dog training advice.
Like this concept
that get him on the show. We'll be the bad guys.
This concept that like, okay, now can your dog be an asset to your two dog pack for the new dog? Absolutely. But this concept that the dog is going to teach the puppy life, obedience, state of mind. Mm-mm. No, it's not going to happen.
All a good puppy raiser, even if the dog is a good puppy raiser, is teaching the puppy how to not be a pain in the ass, really.
Because it'll correct it.
It'll correct it.
Because someone has to.
Right. That's what a good puppy raising dog will do. But it's not going to be like, hey, puppy. Our owners love it when we downstay for a long time and don't get into things.
So let's downstay. Right. It's like people have been reading too many fucking comics. It's like, oh yeah, this is great when let's one puppy says to the other puppy, let's bark at the door. Why? Because then we stop barking and they give us a treat. Yeah. It's like a cartoon. It's like, no, it doesn't like, no.
And like that makes me, that just makes me so nervous leaving an adult dog with a puppy not crated, unsupervised. Like, what if you guys have to leave?
But that's also how you end up with a dead dog. But not only that, excuse me, you, even if you just had one dog,
yeah,
just leaving a puppy.
Yeah, you just
super,
you need, and that's how they learn bladder control.
Right,
like you need to teach. But also, how to hold
a and it's like it's not the mud. Like, well, we put them in the mud room. A mud room is not a crate. A crate is a crate is a crate.
Yeah.
It's like, what is the big deal?
Puppy can still poop and pee all over the mud room.
So right now, this puppy is lying down in its crate.
What kills me though is when people crate train and they get the biggest crate possible,
which you don't need,
and then they wonder why the dog still has accidents.
Right. So this dog right here, if it wasn't in a crate, if we just like put it's on a blanket right now, if we just put the blanket on the ground, it most likely would not be on the blanket. It probably, and that doesn't mean
all over the place.
But that doesn't mean it wouldn't necessarily be doing anything wrong, but it would be walking all over. So the podcast studio is in my bedroom. So it'd be walking all over the bedroom. I've got
a trash bin in the bathroom,
and then the laundry machines are right off my bedroom. And then also, Tex is lying down. Also, we've got tons of power equipment, cords and stuff, underneath the table that we're on that power these lights. And what do you think the dog would be doing? Do you really think that dog, that puppy, would be making the right choice? Now, when our dogs are here, which they are, they're lying down because they're trained. That's what they do. But a puppy, no. It's like, that's like having a one-year-old that's just starting to crawl and be like, oh, don't worry. One-year-old will make all the right choices. No, it won't. Next.
Stacy said, yep, we walk Home Depot and we go to the Kroger dog park. I call it the front of Kroger.
Yeah.
A lot of obstacles to figure eight, walk in people.
Yeah. It's standing outside of like supermarkets because of the carts and all the people, especially different demographics of people, outside of home centers because of the heavier carts, the lumber, the carts rattle a lot. None of those fucking wheels are sitting straight at all. You get all that exposure. Exposure is everything.
Yeah.
That's so people have to realize that's a good part of socialization is all that exposure. Next.
Holly said, our county often refuses owner surrenders of and owners are turning dogs loose on the public versus training or putting them down. Not shaming, but sad how hopeless, desperate people can be.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, this is the thing.
But it's sad.
You're always going to see people that like literally abandon their dogs. They tie them to a post and abandon them. Those make especially if it's caught on videotape, that makes social media. That's really, really big.
I actually just saw a video like that the other day. Mm. Not even kidding.
Mm. And obviously that's terrible. But this is the thing. A huge amount of the population is struggling out there with behavioral issues. And they're not getting help. They're not getting help. And they could get help. But social media is brainwashing them that the stuff that actually works actually doesn't work. It makes it worse a lot of the times. Next.
Sid says, evening, JJ and friends.
Hey, Sid.
Alicia said, no, I've never seen her fight.
Yeah. If you want to get a handle on that, the sheriffing and stuff, teach the dog the out command. There's some free videos on YouTube out away from people. Even if you did out with resource guarding, that will help too. Next, sorry.
Dog lovers, I'm a pet sitter and walked into my first visit this weekend to a doodle pup they refused to crate and saw that he ate an entire house plant, half the potting soil, and 90% of the plastic pot was in it. Owners were like, oh, he does that.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, my God.
So, and that's not a problem.
Oh, he does that.
So
there's so many toxins in potting soil, too. That's disgusting.
But also, let's be realistic.
Like pesticides and shit.
The dog could die.
Yeah.
So let's just be really, really realistic here. The dog could die. And this is what troubles me.
And he ate a plastic pot. Like, how's that going to come out?
Right, that could end up ripping intestines. Okay? Ripping stomach, ripping intestines, ripping colon. This is the thing. You could choose not to have those clients. You can say, sorry, I don't want you as my client. Because what's going to happen is this. The dog will die on your watch, possibly. And it's going to be you. Yep. We hired so-and-so pet sitters. We went out of town. And we got a call 2 days into it that our dog had died. Now, what you don't hear about is they refused to crate the dog, and the dog bit an electrical cord, or the dog choked on something, or the dog ate a bunch of stuff and then like it got impacted. That's the part that they leave out. They leave out their responsibility in the actual death of the dog. So I would be like, no, I won't. I'm not going to take you as a client. But I don't know what person is okay with a dog. They probably aren't crating their dog because they think it's mean, most likely, or else they crate their dog. Mm. I mean, it's like, why don't you crate your dog? Because it's mean to crate the dog. Right. But meanwhile, I guess it's okay because they said, oh, the dog does it nonchalantly. But I guess they feel it's okay for a dog to destroy a plant and to eat plastic and to eat potting soil, which has fertilizer in it.
Yeah. So I just
said. Yeah. So that's okay. That's not mean. That's ha-ha funny. But crating is mean. It's interesting what people, how they look at things, Next.
Destiny said, yep, had a very serious conversation with them on how concerned I was about that and how dangerous it was, and told them that I refused to watch the dog again.
Good. Excellent. Good for you.
Yeah.
You have every right to seek out the right client for you. Next.
Avi says, hey, everyone. Hey, Avi.
Hey, Avi.
Constance, good evening, J&J.
Hey, Constance.
Hey, Constance. Snuggle Bonds, had my first excess issue with my service dog today. The manager at my grocery store was misinformed about service dogs, requiring paperwork to prove their training. I was allowed in, but only because I showed him a dog tag that says service dog. I shopped, upset, and my medical condition worsened as time went on. I tried to see if I could find him on our way out, but there was no sign. Well, they always email a customer satisfaction survey, so I filled it out with my experience and explained the laws, and within hours got an email back saying that they would have his manager speak to him about what he is and isn't allowed to ask, so hopefully he won't do that to another person in the future now that he's informed about the law.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Can't do that. Alicia said, definitely plan on getting on the same page, meaning he can choose to train her how he wishes, but I'm definitely going to be more strict with my dog.
That's not the same page. If you guys are you guys cohabitating?
Yes, yeah, so she can still do whatever she wants, though. As long as he's not undermining you. Like, oh, I'm going to let the dog out of the
car. But he is going to undermine her because he's doing what he wants.
No, with his own dog.
Oh, got it.
Two different dogs.
Got it. But do they cohabitate or not? Because if they cohabitate, there's
she
no...
She says they're going to be in the same home, so I'm assuming okay, they cohabitate.
So there's no such thing as I.
Sure there is. If one is your dog and one is his, like, I don't really take care of texts.
Yes, you do.
I let him out and like walk him.
You.
But if you were like, I don't want to crate texts, I'm not gonna like fight with you about it. I'd be like, okay, crate
texts. Okay, no, there's we. Relationships are about we, not I. First of all, let's please clarify that.
Okay.
You don't think so?
Certain things I feel like are not worth the fight. Honestly,
what's there to fight about?
If they're gonna argue about the way the dog is crate trained, that is not worth it to me. I would just be like, shut your mouth and I'm going to do what I do.
Okay. Well, then who's going to pay for all the damages?
She is going to crate train the dog. She is.
Right. But with his dog. I thought his dog is
his
the one.
His dog's fine.
Oh.
It's the adult German Shepherd.
Oh. Okay. I thought it was the new puppy.
New puppy is Alicia.
Oh, okay. I got it.
Not. I don't think she's gotten it yet. She's
got
being
it.
That proactive.
Got it.
That she's
got
getting
it.
Advice right. Before she gets the dog.
Relationships are still we. Next.
Let's see. Dog lover said, I don't want to set myself up for a death on my watch. It's crazy how people don't think these dangerous behaviors already. Don't take these dangerous behaviors seriously. Yeah.
They don't. No, but they get upset about bonking a dog or an e-cow on a dog or a leash
meanwhile,
pop on a dog.
Insights
they get upset about that, but they don't get upset about your dog like dying from, you know, something toxic that they ate.
Stacy says, resource guarding issues. One of our dogs likes to carry her food.
Carry her food?
Like what? Take little pieces of kibble and walk around? She should be eating in a crate.
Feed the dog. We're big advocates of feeding in crates. Mm-hmm. We're big advocates of feeding in crates. Why? Because it's safe. That's why. It's the safest thing to do. It really is.
Especially
But if you don't
carry her shit around.
But if you have resource guarding, though, we can stop resource guarding. But so having your dog eat in its crate is not a resource guarding technique. It's just dog ownership. Like, who wants food all over their fucking dog food all over their fucking house? Because then the dog's going to be dropping it, and then you're going to have a dog that's constantly looking for scraps all over the house and like possibly hiding their food for a later date. And just feed the dog in the crate. Dog's eating what, 3 minutes, 5 minutes? Next.
Snugglebun said, "Oh, and my service dog did excellent supporting me today. No food or treats, and he worked great." That's something good. You've been working hard on that.
I would take away all food or treats unless you're doing a new task.
Alicia said, haha, yeah, exactly my point. So I'm going to be crate training and I'm very strict. I like structure. So your way is my way. Ever since Drake, that's all I've known.
Yeah, structure is like, structure, if people just did structure, their lives would change.
Kelly said, 2 Dobies love to play, but 1-year-old starts to get overstimulated, starts to lose it. I keep calling them over mid-play to treat and calm. Is this the best way to teach?
No. Well, this is what I would do. We use food as well, but people got to give up food at some point. You got to just give up the food. Stop with the food. Teach the dog the out command. Teach both dogs the out command, which they will then immediately disengage and be calm. So in a way, you're teaching recall in drive, which is a good skill to have. But are you really teaching calm? Okay. Next.
Alicia said, thanks for the validation. I know I didn't need it, but still, LOL. Gonna finish class. I'll watch the replay tomorrow. Love y'all. Have a good night.
Take care.
Sam said she also wanted to lay down the whole class when we were standing still. I made her sit for the whole thing, corrected when she lay down. Seemed like she wanted to lay down to try to relax. Was I wrong to make her sit?
Did you say sit or did you say down? So this is what's really interesting. There's a lot of times back at the old training center, we put a lot of dogs. We have a sitting in chair protocol. We'd have a dog sitting in a chair because it's hard to do. Actually helped with whining too.
It did. I think that's why she's doing it, because I told her to do squat to sit.
Yeah, sitting in a chair, which is
But in those scenarios, sometimes I'll let the dog lay down and freaking avoid if that's what they want.
Yeah, it depends on like,
like, what's the better behavior?
What's going
if she's
on?
Quiet and calm laying down, I'll freaking take the calm all day.
Yeah.
So I guess I would have tried both.
Yeah. Yep.
Waddle says, who do you guys recommend on YouTube with some extra training advice? We have an 8-month-old Malinois.
Us.
What we do thousands of videos.
This is what we do for a living.
It's at Solid Canine Training on YouTube as well.
Yeah. But they might not know.
I mean, they're on Instagram. Maybe they just found us.
So we've got podcasts twice a week. We've got thousands of videos. We have an online academy of courses. We have we actually train dogs. We're real dog trainers. Like, we're working dogs here. Our head trainer is working dogs at down the street at her place. So we can train your dog to do. We're family pet dog trainers. Train your dog to do any command that you would need for a family pet, and we can stop any unwanted behavior, and we can help with your dog's state of mind. So we recommend us. That doesn't mean we're the best. Doesn't mean there's not good people, but we're going to recommend us because you can learn everything you need to know from us. Next.
Stacy says, as a part-time Rover sitter in my home, she kicked out her roommates, turned their empty rooms into a super safe one dog per room, no interactions with other guests. Yeah, that's good.
Good.
Let's see. Stacy also said the dog picks up the bowl and hides it in our bed.
What? The food bowl?
The food bowl.
That's gross.
Yeah, you gotta stop that, Stacy.
Stacy, so just reverse engineer this. Number one, how's the dog getting your bowl into your bed? I know, but it's like, but if you think about it, it's like, what, think about all the things you can do to prevent all that. Number one, feed the dog in the crate. Number two, don't let the dog get on the bed without permission. Number three, don't let the dog carry the damn bowl around. So you got three things there. Next.
Natasha, hey guys, I've been practicing your techniques from Walk the Walk with my German Shepherd. My goal is to be able to have her walk calmly in any situation. There's a night and day difference between how she used to walk me to me enjoying my walks with her.
Good. But that's congratulations.
Walk the Walk is such a good course.
Yeah. If this is the thing, you nailed it on the head by, I think you, that one sentence where you said,
she used to walk me.
No, the enjoyable.
Now we're reading the whole thing.
No, enjoyable for her.
I'm enjoying my walk.
Yeah, I'm enjoying my walk. Like that's the magic.
That's the goal.
That is supposed to be the goal. Everybody is focused on, everyone's like, oh, well, the walk is for the dog too. Okay. Yes. But a lot of dogs love pulling. A lot of dogs love marking. A lot of dogs.
I can't even imagine they love that though.
A lot, but let's pretend they did.
Like, what a shit walk! You're just like.
A lot of dogs
choking the whole time.
Well, they're not stopping.
That's true.
So a lot of dogs love lunging at everything. A lot of dogs love doing a lot of unwanted behaviors that we don't love. We need to take back our walks for us, and these are the rules. Now, we play Chuck It and Frisbee at the park at least once a day. Dogs can, you know, obviously they're there to play fetch and they do because they love that. But if they want to lie down or go take a potty break or go sniff the ground or go rub up against a tree or go do whatever, like they can. But the walk is like, you're walking. Let's walk. Like we're going on a walk. It's structure. There's so much training opportunity
but
on
that's
the walk.
The thing is, like, the people who say, oh, the walk is for the dog are the people who don't give their dogs off-leash freedom because they don't believe in freaking reliable e-collar training. So their dogs are confined to the house and they get one walk around the neighborhood and that's good enough.
Right.
We want, like, way more than that right. for our dogs and our yeah. clients.
That's why. And it's not that hard to do. It's not that hard to achieve. Next.
Jan says, howdy. Hey, Jan.
Hey, Jan.
Paracella dog training. I train in New York City and I'm often the third or fourth trainer that people go to after multiple force-free positive only fails them. The force-free is out of control here.
Yeah, I'm pretty outspoken about force-free. I've actually done podcasts on it, how it's a scam. And keep in mind, there's a puppy that is here for 2 weeks. I'm doing all clicker food training with this dog. I'm doing all reward-based training with this dog. It's just a puppy. It's 2 weeks, which only gives us enough time to, like, train the basics. It's all going to be done with reward-based training. All of it. But there's a huge difference between reward-based training, positive reinforcement, which is reward-based training, and force-free training. Once you identify yourself as a force-free trainer, you're identifying yourself as a scam artist. And this is nobody in particular. This is no trainer in particular. It's the phrase. It is the industry. There is no such thing as force-free. And people love to say, I don't know what I'm talking about. It's like, yes, I do. Like, how many times do I have to read the force-free mission statement from dozens or I'll do it off of 100 websites if I have to not understand it. I do understand it. And it's not possible to train a dog completely force-free. It's not possible to stop an unwanted behavior force-free. You're saying it for marketing, for your ego, and that's it. But you're not saying it to be honest. Now, reward-based training works, but has its limits. You're not going to stop aggression. You're not going to stop separation anxiety. You're not going to stop leash reactivity. And people say, oh, I did. I'm like, show me the beginning, during, and after video, and I'll show you where you did not use rewards. Keep in mind, we correct dogs. We apply punishers. It's only 5% of what we do. 95% of what we do is not that. So imagine like how easy that 5% is to be overlooked. We can put out training videos of our dogs doing incredible stuff and make it only look like we're using rewards. It's not that difficult to do. So I think it's important that people understand what they're purchasing, what they're getting into. what issues they have, what the limitation of the training is. So it's concerning because so many owners are giving up, but they haven't even effectively started. They've started, but not effectively started. Next.
Stacy said, you guys are really good teachers. Thank you.
Thank you.
Caro's Bees, Beeston Bowl. How do you react if people bash you for using e-collar? I live in Belgium. Now it's night here. And in 2027, it's going to be forbidden to use it here on dogs. I get a lot of bashing from people who are in the positive only. Right. And who are saying that I shock my dog,
right?
But I know better. And I want to know how you react to people bashing you because you use it.
So I've been doing this for 20 years. No one has been bashed more than I have. No one. I'm the OG of trying to cancel a dog trainer. It's just the way it is. It's just the truth. I don't react or respond.
Yeah. You're not going to change their mind.
Why would you react?
These people are closed-minded.
Why would you respond? Why would you defend yourself? Now, I'm predicting the downfall. You guys, by the way, Belgium, you're going to lose all your dog sports, by the way.
Can't you guys not even crate your dogs over there? Oh, no, that's Germany.
Sweden.
Germany, too, now, right? Yeah.
So, by the way, you're going to lose all your dog sports. All bite work is going to be stopped in Belgium. So, you can overrule this. You can overrule this. You have time.
Yeah.
You have time. It's all based on everybody's thinking that it's better for the dog. It's more humane. But that's because they're misinformed. That's because people are misinformed. There's a highly misinformed audience. There's a misinformed audience just about dog ownership in general, not even training. But why would you respond to somebody that bashed you? Why would you waste your time? It's just ignore. Mm-hmm. Ignore them.
Because you know your dog is living a great life.
Right.
Most likely has way more freedom.
Right. Last night I made liver and onions for dinner.
The fuck does that have to do with anything?
Does anybody want to bash me for my food choice? I don't give a shit. It was fucking great. And I had the leftovers for lunch today.
Liver's good for you.
But it's like, but
train yourself.
But why would I care? Oh my God, that's terrible. That's disgusting. How could you be eating meat? Or how could you be eating liver and onions? That's gross. I'm like, what am I gonna do? Explain to them how good it is?
It's the secret to us aging well, okay?
Okay.
Can we stay young?
You are young.
it's Botox free.
Okay. Like, don't defend yourself. Literally stop. Your life will become much easier if you just stop. Stop giving a shit what other people say. Next.
Krista says, kid example, instead of nagging our children to stop a behavior, why don't we stop it by taking away the option to continue it? Dogs, our dog is eating out of the trash. Why don't we crate our dog or use place as an option to control the situation?
Or you have a consequence for eating out of the trash. You go to eat out of the trash. I use those e-collars.
She said also make it freaking suck.
Yeah. LOL. Yeah. Make it suck. And then you don't have to worry about crating. I mean, you still should crate your dog, but I'm not going to put my dog in place so it doesn't eat out of the trash. I'm going to correct my dog for eating out of the trash. I'm going to have my dog in place most likely for better household management. Next.
Krista said, laugh my ass off. I'm done. Y'all crack me the F up. Thanks, Krista. I love her.
What did we say that was funny?
I don't know. Probably we were bickering over the crate stuff.
Oh.
Relationship stuff.
Oh.
Because Krista's like, bullshit, relationships are two-sided. She's a control freak just like I am.
Well.
She gets it.
It's supposed to be a union and it's supposed to be we. There's not supposed to be any I.
Until it comes to the dog.
That's,
then it's whatever the woman says.
I'm just.
As long as she's right.
And I disagree with that. I'm just letting you know. I'm telling you, from a relationship standpoint,
it's whoever has the best interest of the dog in mind is right. We're on the same page with dog ownership.
You're missing the point though about this. People get into relationships and are like I, and it's like no, it's we.
I think it's okay to have some autonomy.
I didn't say there's not. Next,
Sid. Got a call, 2-year-old unsocialized German Shepherd. Owner took to a family gathering. Kid showed up running around. Dog bit a kid. Yep. Now they want to give the dog away.
Okay.
Sad, stupid human. Yep. Dog could get killed.
Yep. Okay. There you go. Looks like they'll be giving the dog away. Whoever wants a kid biting German Shepherd in Rhode Island, there's one available. God. You know?
Could all be stopped with simple training.
They could have not bought the dog as well. They could have not brought their under-socialized apex predator to a gathering where there'd be running kids. They could have also done that. Like, that would be the smart thing to do.
So did they ask for training, Sid? Or are they just like, I'm going to get rid of my dog now? Like, at least try training.
Some people would rather go from not trying to...
That just seems so extreme to me. Christos. I can't with her. I'm fucking dead. I'm sorry. I'm literally dying. Joelle knows me so well.
Well, that's Krista. Well, that's Krista. Nashville Krista?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. You both
are the same. I know.
You both are fucked up. Yeah. I know that was that Krista. Oh, Krista. Yeah. You both are fucked up.
We're so the same.
Yeah.
We have our list, and you better fucking follow it.
The two of you should find a fucking deserted island and just move to it.
It'd be great. We talk to each other for like 5 minutes of the day and then like go
do our own thing. It's so funny how you would like, we're so the same, and it's like you would drive each other crazy, probably.
I don't think so.
I think you would. This is why you would drive yourself crazy, because
our OCD would be like start kicking.
It's because constantly looking in the mirror.
Yeah, true.
It's like constantly looking in the mirror.
But I feel like we set boundaries, and we wouldn't get all upset over it.
Okay.
Stacey says training the word no is important. Yeah. Yes, it is.
Putting meaning to the word no. Absolutely. Yes.
Bully says when a client calls for help and ready to do the work and then their husband won't agree, I say, tell him to stand back and watch while you do the work. And eventually he sees it works and thinks it's his idea, just like a man, and starts to help.
Hey, don't be sexist. Ladies.
This show is out of control.
Ladies. Okay.
I can't.
Ladies, seriously. There's so much. There's so much, it's so funny. There's so much sexism. It's like,
if the tables were turned, we'd be pissed.
Okay, exactly.
Just like a woman.
It's like, it's incredible. It's like, meanwhile, I do the dishes, I cook dinner.
It's true.
And I actually even vacuum tonight. And that's not unique. It's like, but it's just like this concept of like, and trust me, we have roles. Like we do believe in gender roles.
For sure.
What those roles are, that doesn't mean men do physical stuff and women do.
No, we've agreed upon it.
Yeah, but we have gender roles, and the thing is though is like it's so funny how females can be so quick to say something, and I'm like, if a male said that, it would be like,
oh yeah, I think there's definitely
the Me Too police would be all over them.
Double standard.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely. Yep.
Like I will never kill a bug or empty a mouse trap. No, you'll never catch me doing it.
Yeah, I know. I've heard the screams. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Alicia.
Remember that one time you were in the shower? She's taking a fucking shower.
It was the scary,
I'm relaxing.
Weird, like, worm.
I'm relaxing. And I'm like, the only time that I want to hear Joelle in the shower scream, Jeff, can you come here? Is when she wants me to take a shower with her. Other than that, I'm really not interested in, like, hearing her screams, Jeff, get in here. It's like, I get in there and it's like, She's like in the corner of the shower, crumpled up like this. And there's a fucking spider on the wall.
No, it was like that weird like caterpillar thing. It was like crawling up the wall.
Okay, it was a half a centimeter, whatever, 5 millimeter thing that literally a thumb could have extinguished. Next.
Stacey says, do y'all do couples counseling?
No.
We're dog trainers. Where we draw the line.
No, but we work with families a lot, and we do help families navigate disagreements. Absolutely.
Alicia said, how do I get Figaro to eat in his kennel with the door shut? He only eats in the kennel if the door is open.
Okay.
Because right now, he's still learning how to not be stressed in the kennel.
Mm-hmm.
So he's probably too stressed to eat when the door is
shut. But here's a really quick way to do it. Put the food in the kennel, close the kennel, walk away. Come back 15 minutes later, take the bowl out, do it again at night. Same thing. 15 minutes later, take the bowl out. Let's see how long it lasts the dog that it won't eat in its kennel with the door closed. Dogs don't starve themselves to death. They'll eat. They'll eat. Next.
GB Bucks, best dog, said, especially if they chase deer or kill rabbits, you can reward with food, but you need a punisher.
Yep. The timing and the sequence is so important. It's so, so important. People, you got to be really careful. It's no different than a dog jumps on a person and you call the dog to you and you reward the dog. It's like, so there was no in there, no consequence in there. So that's the sequence. Oh, I get it. When someone comes over the house, I jump, because this is how you chain commands together. It's used in task training and trick training and also a lot of, you know, sports stuff and a lot of agility and things like that. It's dog jumps on the person, gets down, runs to the owner, sits, gets fed. That's what you're training. That's what you're training. So be careful about sequences. Next.
Snugglebun said, I made some progress with my Papillon. A small child walked past her and her down stay with her arm outstretched towards her and she didn't move or growl. She also let my coworker hold her today.
Next.
Awesome. Good job.
That's great.
Keith said, hi, Jeff from good old Rhode Island. We miss you.
Oh, hey, Keith. How are you? How you doing? don't take it personally. I don't fucking miss it. It's
the people, but not.
Yeah.
People.
Yeah. You're guy.
Obviously, we miss our clients.
There's it's not like I, you know, can't stand, you know, the whole existence, but it's more about like, I mean, you were just up there and it was just gray every day. And
my whole state of being changes when I go up there.
As soon as you land.
Yeah.
As soon as you land. And then now they got that 195 freaking construction.
Insane.
Yeah.
Dan says, love the content. No question tonight. Just a thank you. Wife and I started our own training business in Rhode Island, trying to help fill the void you left.
Nice.
Continuing to learn from you guys and hope to come and take a course down there.
Yeah, we have a mastermind.
Mm-hmm. October.
We have a mastermind, but also we do an online the 90-day fast track. Dan, might be good for you too.
Yeah.
You know, if you got any problems with clients and...
We have a lot of trainers in there right now. Yeah. Actually, we're literally coaching them with client dogs.
Yeah, we can help you out. Absolutely.
Let's see. Sid said, LOL, born and trained for 8-month-old Jack Russell Cross. Wanted to walk well on leash, not jump, follow commands,
mm-hmm.
recall,
mm-hmm.
not using tools,
mm-hmm.
but okay with bonker. Dog is owned by an 81-year-old owner. I gave the deposit back. We're not miracle workers. No tools at all.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. It's like, can you do it? Sure. You know,
interesting. He's okay with the bonker, but not a remote collar, which is easier.
It's going to be one of the best thing that the 80-year-old
easier for him. Dexterity-wise.
E-collars are great for every dog. That doesn't mean every dog has to use them, but they're great for every dog. And I can't stand the narrative that they're, oh, certain dogs. No, all dogs can be trained on an e-collar, 100%. Whether they are or not, that's a different story. But they can be. You can't say that about food because there's dogs that are not food motivated. So, but an e-collar for someone that's in their 80s, it's a great tool.
Yeah.
They would love it. So, but when I'm always interested in the psychodynamic of the person. It's like they put these hard nose on certain things. It's like, so why not? So can I use a leash? Can I use food? Like, what tools are you allowing me to use? And then what training philosophy? It's like you're hiring a professional. You're like, you hired me for results, I hope. Hopefully you hired me for results. So we're a results-oriented business. Next.
Brittany, hey guys, we went to the dog expo with Kinsey and he rocked it. His down place is bomb-proof, blows people's minds. It really is crazy how low the expectations are for puppies, me included, before all of this.
Yeah.
My husband and I were like little kids talking about all the things we'll be able to do with him out and about.
Yeah.
Even knowing that when we go out, we'll have a newborn soon and our lives will be straight chaos. We are going to be able to fall back into his training.
Yep.
And I love taking him out.
Yeah.
Love that.
Yeah, it's.
He looks so good in the videos too.
It's incredible how low the bar is.
Yeah.
It really, really is. And then when you've got a baby on the way, it's like you need to really, you know, step it up because everything changes. Everything changes with a baby. Yep.
Snuggle Bun says, I will limit how many rewards I give him for working. We just trained a new retrieval task and he takes allergy medication twice a day and joint supplements. So I always ask him to do something for
them. Oh, good. Good.
JW said, eat some liver and get some high nutrition. That's right.
Yeah. Liver's great.
Packed with nutrients.
Love it. Love it. I did it. I think I made it the same way as
I don't think I'm quite there with love it, but I can eat it.
You struggle with the veins.
It's the texture for me.
But
not even so much the taste.
Angela and I love it. I did mushrooms.
But I know it's good for
green pepper. Green peppers, onions, mushrooms, and then breaded liver. Tonight that roast was fucking good.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, like I feel like I went total opposite with my diet the past few years. I went from strictly plant-based. Now I'm like leaning almost like carnivore, and I feel so much better these days.
Mm. That roast, what was that roast? Cooked a roast today, had it in the oven for almost 3 hours. I think it was freaking tender. Had some cooking wine on it, some beef broth on it, onions, peppers, potatoes.
Little potatoes.
Yeah. Love it when the potatoes come out right too. It was so good.
Joyful Canine said management fails, so definitely make it aversive for the what if moment.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, management's important, but you know, training fails. Training fails, just in general.
Rebecca says, my foster I've had for 3 weeks will not down in place with the e-collar. She will cower and run under a table or hide in the crate. This has never happened before with other dogs.
Okay. Welcome to the world of training. You know what I mean? So even though it's a foster, maybe you're not a trainer, maybe you're an owner, but we see it all the time. Number one, from what you described, it sounds like there's not a leash on the dog, or else the dog couldn't hide in the crate or run underneath something. Make sure you pattern down lots of times off of place over and over and over and over again. Also, I'm not sure if you're familiar with the way we train e-collar with priming CS, NCS. But you can also use, if you do it that way, you can also be using leash pressure and food as well. It's possible that you're going too high because the dog downs, excuse me, and other applications, but it's not downing on the place bed. A lot of dogs get nervous downing on a place bed because they move, the beds move. It's not as stable of a surface. I mean, if you're part of our coaching or if you did a consult, if you made a video, I'd be able to troubleshoot that in like, you know, seconds what the problem is. Next.
Snugglebun said, I was just always told by the service dog community to use the highest value reward for his tasks, but I do notice that he works without expecting a reward most of the time. I'm feeling off.
Well, let's clarify a couple of things. At the beginning stages of training, let alone task training, yes. Yes, it should be fun. There's a couple of things that are missing from the service dog task training world. The accountability factor. The proof factor, the lack of a consequence. Now, some service dog training facilities absolutely correct dogs. Like anybody that trains dogs for the blind, they use aversives. They do. I mean, and they're very firm. They're very, very intense because the person could die. If a dog walks somebody out into traffic, you could die. If a dog walks somebody like off of like, I don't want to say a cliff, but some sort of surface, you know. I mean, dogs for the blind are trained to stop at anything above like an inch and a half so the person doesn't trip. But in service dogs, let's say you trained your dog. This is why using a punisher for a service dog is important. Let's say your dog is trained to retrieve something out of the fridge. Well, how about if they do it 10 times in a row and now you've got 10 bottles of water sitting in front of you? How about if a dog is trained to retrieve something off of a counter? Well, how about if they start retrieving everything off of the counter, even things that you didn't ask for? So there has to be a consequence for messing up your tasks. But at the beginning stages, yeah, it's all like awesome, fun, you know, rewarding stuff. But to proof it, you want it to be, there has to be a consequence. There has to be a consequence to make sure the dog's reliable. Or like, think about even like, you know, a dog that's, you know, a seizure alert dog or a diabetic alert dog giving you false signals. That can be terrible. Or could you imagine a diabetic alert dog not signaling? You could die. You could actually die. That's why a lot of diabetic alert dog trainers have gotten out of the industry, because people weren't keeping up with the stuff and they were treating the dog more like a family pet than a working dog. And now people are complaining that the dog's not triggering on low or high blood sugar. It's like, and then people are being sued. So I know of a trainer in particular that unfortunately was in that position. His life unraveled, actually. Yeah. Next.
3803. I know. Joyful Canine said liver and onions is great. I sometimes blend up into pate, roll it into iceberg lettuce wraps with hard-boiled egg, tomato, and cucumber.
There you go.
Pate. I do like pate.
Mm-hmm.
Not gonna lie.
Mm-hmm.
When you used to get it in like the little containers and we'd eat it with like crackers.
A lot of that was RV food too.
Yeah.
Yeah. We used to eat so well in the RV. Oh my God.
Ugh, you and your caviar. Ugh.
But pate.
I can't do caviar.
I can make pate.
Sky Soldier Dog Training. I'm glad you're saying it, Jeff. Can't tell you how many dogs I failed for CGC tests because they were trained purely positive, force-free, and the owners just couldn't understand.
Yeah, I mean, it's not that difficult of a concept. You know, it's just not. I mean, the concept that you can't hold a dog accountable, that's what it is. It's accountability. So you've got the accountability aspect of it, but then you also have the stopping of the unwanted behavior aspect of it. But to go through life without those two, could you imagine going through life without those two things? It'd be crazy. It'd be crazy. And if people love to humanize, well, we can humanize this all day long. Raising kids, it doesn't work. It does not work. So, and dogs are apex predators. So people better be careful. Next.
Let's see. Ama says, sometimes I worry about what people think when they see me correct my dog in public, because people these days, but what they don't see is the peace I have behind doors in my home with him listening. Right. Consequences are effective and reduce once you set boundaries and they learn. And I tell you, my dog loves me no less and isn't fearful of me one bit.
I mean, I get it. Makes you normal, but, and I can't say don't worry about it, because that's like telling someone not to be depressed or to smile more, you know, but when you become at peace with yourself and you become comfortable in your own skin, other people's opinions of you don't matter. First of all, other people's opinions of you are not who you are or factual. That's just their opinion of you. If I went by what people's opinions of me were, like, I'm fucked. So I'm not overly concerned, because I know I'm a good person and I know I do the right thing. And someone that has got like, that would be saying something to you, just the fact that they're doing that, that makes them not a nice person. Mm. Like they've already like shot themselves out of they're nice, because they're not nice. So always look at it as, if you want to, that's not your issue, it's their issue. That's something they're struggling with. It's their unresolved problems, trauma, issues. It's not your problem. It's their problem. So if anything, have empathy for them. I feel really bad that you feel that you need to pass judgment upon others, that you have unresolved issues that you're not comfortable with and you need to knock somebody or something in order for you to feel better. I'm sorry that you're still dealing with some childhood trauma, some parenting trauma, some spousal trauma, some relationship trauma. Really, really sorry. And I hope you get help for that. but it has honestly nothing to do with me. Like, you should see all these rants, you know, that I will get hating on me from people. And I'll show it to Joelle. And I'll be like, and it's always a she, not a sexist comment based on fact. Guess who she's talking about?
Not you.
Her dad, a boss,
someone,
a past relationship. Mm-hmm. She's not actually talking to
me. A lot of people just have a lot of anger and unprocessed emotions inside. And now the internet has given them place to unhinge those emotions.
Yeah, but it's not like you haven't resolved your issues yet. People that have resolved their own personal issues don't do these things. They don't spread all this hate online. Like, they don't do that. People with issues, unresolved issues, that's who does these things. Stable people don't do these things. Next.
Snuggle Buns and Joelle, your shirt is adorable, by the way. Thank you. I wore some colors tonight. It's not usually what I do.
It's a sweater.
But it was a crochet. Sunshiny day today. It was feeling very,
really, really nice. Great. Actually. Yeah. Today was.
My best friend Rosie just moved to Florida, and she's been texting me the last couple of days. She's like, I feel like a new person here. I'm like, yeah, welcome to the sunshine.
It makes a difference.
Where it's not snowing and gray every day.
That makes a difference.
It really does.
Being warm with it.
Alicia said he spills it all over. Oh, she tries to feed him in the kennel.
Well,
give him a little bit of a time then. He's obviously not that hungry.
Is this the one that if she closes the door?
Yeah.
He won't eat?
He won't eat.
But the door open?
But with the door open, he'll eat it.
Fuck it. Let him spill it all over. Let him spill it all over. He'll eat it. Next.
Sky Soldier Dog Training said, my wife ran the social media account for months because she said I was triggering the 20-something white girls. What a time to be alive. That's all I have to say.
It's very interesting. We had an interesting discussion today about a lot of stuff.
LOL, she rehabs aggressive dogs, but bugs are freaky. Love you, Joelle. Yeah, man, I don't do bugs. I'll take a biting dog over a freaking bug any day. They freak me out big time. But then, like, I get weird guilt if I kill one because I'm like, imagine being killed just for being in the wrong place at the wrong time. I have empathy for the bugs. That's why I made you just in that night. I said, just put it outside. Don't smash it.
And I did.
Right.
And then you were like, where'd you put it? I'm like, right by the front door.
I know. I wanted to Google.
So we had our front door. It's all hardscape. Right to the right of our front door. It's all hardscape. 3/4-inch stones with all kinds of other stuff in there. And half an hour prior, I put this bug out there. And then she has to walk out there and be like, where'd you put it? I'm like, I put it right out there. Where? I don't see it. I'm like, you really fucking think you'd see it?
I wanted to Google lens it because I'd just never seen anything like it in my life. And I did end up finding another one and I Google lensed it. And it's a sort of caterpillar that creates a
screaming.
No, screaming it makes person. Like a little capsule of like hair, like it'll collect dog hair and like lint, and it hangs out in its little thing, and then all you see coming out of it is its little tail, and then it crawls up the wall with its little sack, and that's what I'm like, it looks like an amoeba or something.
Sounds like an uncircumcised penis crawling up your wall.
It's freaky. It was really weird.
And it warranted you screaming and getting me out of bed.
Yeah.
Rushing in there.
Brittany says, watching Calm on Command with Kate, Courtney deserves a damn badge with that guy. Her patience with him is so impressive.
Yeah.
Courtney is so patient.
He was just in for
Boarding.
For boarding.
Mm-hmm. He did good.
Yeah, he did actually great.
Farmer Joe, J&J, always appreciate your knowledge, honesty, and opinion. I have a huge heart for dogs. And with that, I now have 3 German Shepherds, 2 Labs, And now someone abandoned two heelers in January right before the freeze.
Oh, jeez.
I've not been able to find a home for them, so now they need to earn their keep on the farm.
Yeah.
I'm looking for someone to train me and the two dogs so I can use them to work cattle. Any suggestions?
Well, we don't do, I would search for a cattle dog trainer or a sheep herding trainer, but for cattle. I would search for livestock. It's a whole different type of training. But chances are, if you have cattle, that means there's probably people around you that have got cattle, which means there's probably that have got cattle dogs, and they must know. They must know. A lot of people send their dogs away. A lot of people send their sheep dogs and their cattle dogs away. It's a 4-month program usually, and then they come back. They come back. There is some instinct to it, but you got to be careful though.
Sky Soldiers and more stock dogs in Texas. Yeah, I don't know where you are, Farmer Joe, too. But I guess you could send the dog away.
Yeah. Anybody that does stock dogs.
I think I actually follow that.
Yeah, I do.
They have some crazy, amazing dogs in there.
Their dogs are intense. Mm-hmm. And that's why every time I look at these dogs and I see their intenseness and I'm like...
They're literally getting kicked in the head and going back for more.
But I see
their, and people cry but over I, but dogs I see, getting bonked with the
But dog. When I see their dogs, and I'm like... And then we see the dogs that we get in that are a lot of times not mentally stable.
Yeah.
And then you see those dogs. It's like people have got to understand the genetics in dogs.
Oh, she's in Texas.
And how like there's some dogs that are extremely well put together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sky Soldiers had beautiful work of art. Yeah, really.
Oh,
so impressive.
If you're in Texas, you have plenty of opportunities. I'm sure there's plenty of cattle dog trainers. Mm-hmm. Plenty. Yeah. You need to just jump into that circle of people. You'll find them. Yeah. You'll find them. Yeah.
That's it.
All right. Awesome. Awesome, everybody. Thank you so much for being on the show. We really appreciate all of you. Go to Solid Canine Academy, Solid Canine Academy. If you need to do a consult or get any of our courses, feel free. That'd be great if you did. Go to Jeff Gelman Seminars, Jeff Gelman Seminars. I'll be up in Chicago and then New Jersey right across from Philadelphia. That'd be nice if you did that as well. And other than that, everybody have a fantastic, fantastic night. And we'll see everybody on Friday. Take care, everybody.
Good night.